My server is a savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
Good morning. It's so wonderful to be with you this morning, even though we are still apart. There are so many things changing in our world, even still. I'm very aware that the governor has changed some of the prescriptives for how we can gather. He's loosening some of the restrictions. And the thing that I want to say first is that members of our leadership team and our worship committee and I are having conversations about the safest way for us to begin gathering together again. So please keep posted. We'll send out information by email, the newsletter this week, in all the ways that we can to give you some idea of how soon and what we will be doing as we gather together. And as we usually do on a Sunday morning, we are so very grateful for all of you who are joining us. Whether this is your first time to be with us or many times, we hope that you are blessed by this worship service. And so let us begin with our first song as we have the entry of the light of Christ.
Saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he has said? To you who for refuge to Jesus have fled. Fear not, I am with thee, O me not dismayed.
I'll strengthen and help thee and call.
thousands were fed. He touched the blind eyes, healed broken spirits, moved with compassion. He raised up the dead. Once on a hillside, watching as Jesus was crucified, no one showed mercy to the one who had healed them. Yet Jesus loved them as he suffered and died. On a hillside, people were gathered, for Jesus had risen and soon would ascend. Then as he blessed them, he rose to the
gather together. We have the opportunity to pray for one another and to take our prayers to the Lord. I would lift up especially the Tolson family. Alan's father passed away this week, and he also got word that an uncle died on Wednesday. And so prayers for the Tolson family. Continued prayers for Kathy and Mike McGuire. Kathy is having some more tests done. We certainly want to pray for their well-being. We pray for the businesses that are opening up, and for the people who are beginning to gather at those businesses. We are praying for our farmers, and we certainly are praying for rain. And so would you join me now as we take our prayers to the Lord. God of resurrection, hear our prayers. We pray for the church throughout the world, that as we celebrate the great 50 days of Easter, we may renew our faith and strengthen our witness in Jesus' name. We pray for pastors and teachers and ministers, that they recognize the risen Christ in word and sacrament, and that they lead your church with wisdom and humility and courage. We pray for the governments of the world and its leaders, that they may lead with wisdom and with courage and with strength, and that they would serve the common good. We pray for our planet and that all the people may be good stewards of its resources and share in its abundance. God of resurrection, we pray for the poor and the stranger, that they may receive a place of refuge and hope, and that the church may offer the hospitality the first disciple offered to Jesus on the road to Emmaus. Pray for those who are sick and those in distress, that they may find healing for their pain and be restored to fullness of life. We pray for our neighbors, that we may live in peace and share in our resources. And we pray for our enemies, that they may receive good things, and that we, your servants, not return evil for evil. Almighty God, receive these offers, these prayers that we offer, and that you would watch over us and keep us. This we pray in Jesus' most powerful name. Amen. The scripture reading this morning is familiar. It is from Luke chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?' They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, 'It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon.' Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I went on 3 road trips with my dad, and all happened after I turned 40. The first was shortly after I had graduated from seminary and was serving my first appointment. Chris and I, and my dad and my stepmom, traveled from Texas to Tennessee in their minivan. We went places and we saw things that all 4 of us were interested in, including Dollywood and the Grand Ole Opry and Graceland. We spent more time at one time together than we had since I was in middle school. We had so much fun. We talked about it often. The second trip was about 10 years ago, shortly after I had completed chemotherapy for cancer. The 4 of us traveled from Midland to New Mexico, revisiting places that each of us had been before, but not together. And that, too, was a great trip, even though I could sense my dad was not his usual self. The last road trip we took together was 2 years after that, when Chris and I picked him up at the airport in Houston and took him to MD Anderson, where he learned that there was nothing more that they could do for him. And putting him on the plane to return home was heartbreaking. Chris and I talked and we cried about it all the way home. What I didn't know then, and what I have come to understand since, is that each of those road trips served a spiritual purpose. After many years of separation, my dad suggested the first trip to reconnect and to express his acceptance of my call to be a pastor. That wasn't his first choice for me. Now, he never said those actual words, but it was evident in his manner and his actions. The second trip was his way of expressing his love and his relief that I had survived a serious health issue. And it was only after the fact that I realized that that was the message that he wanted to convey. But it was the third trip, when I came face to face with how much my dad loved life and loved his family, and it was that trip that opened my eyes to what kind of relationship he had with God. It was that trip that helped me know God was present with us in ways that went beyond feelings or logical comprehension. And while sad, it was a very good road trip, one that has served me well when I have wondered why things are so difficult, or why things happen the way they do, or when I need to be reminded that I'm not in charge. Jesus was present as a stranger in each of those road trips, and I didn't always recognize him along the way. Today's gospel reading begins with Cleopas and his companion on the road. It's the first day of the week. They were on that 7-mile walk from Jerusalem to Emmaus. They were discussing all of the things that had happened during the past several days. They, too, would have been in Jerusalem for the Passover. They may have been part of the crowd that cried out, "Crucify him." We don't know if they were with those who actually witnessed the crucifixion and saw Jesus's lifeless body put in the tomb. There is a world of possibility in Luke's picture of the two of them walking and talking. See, what they had hoped for didn't seem possible anymore. They thought Jesus would be the Messiah, the one to rescue Israel from its enemies and to lead as a king. Now he was dead, and their hopes were dashed. And as they walked and they talked, I'm sure the conversation was around, where do we go from here? At some point in our lives, we may have taken that walk as well. As one theologian put it, what are the conversations we have on the way to nowhere in particular, when the horizon stretches only as far as the petty pace of tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow permits? What should we do when we have reached our wits' end, when what we once thought was worth our lives has left us washed up emotionally, financially, physically, or spiritually? And though Luke spends only a sentence on the conversation between the disciples before a stranger joins them, we know that that conversation could last a lifetime. But then, seemingly out of nowhere, a stranger joins them and asks what they are talking about. And we may have had that experience as well, so deep in conversation or so deep in concentration that we are oblivious of what's happening around us. And when someone asks what we are talking about or thinking about, we're at first startled and then perhaps just a tad defensive. Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who doesn't know the things that have taken place in these days? I can just imagine Cleopas and his companion raising their eyebrows at each other and sending each other looks that said, "Who is this guy?" I can imagine that good manners and civility rubbed up against, "Go away, you're bothering us." But when the stranger asked, "What things?" they opened up and they told the stranger what was bothering them. And at that, the stranger began to interpret to them all the scriptures about himself from Moses and the prophets. I wonder if Jesus sometimes waits for us to open up and to tell him what's bothering us so that he can reveal himself to us. Well, the three of them walked on, the stranger teaching them and the two others listening. They arrived at their destination, and the stranger kept walking as if to travel on. But Cleopas and his companion urged him to join them for supper, since the day was almost over. Sadness led to curiosity. Curiosity led to interest. Interest led to hospitality. And hospitality led to revelation. Cleopas and his companion extended the invitation, but once inside the house, the stranger became the host. While they were at the table, the stranger, Jesus, took the bread, he blessed and broke it, and he gave it to them. Immediately, their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And as soon as they recognized him, he vanished from their sight. In that moment, in the recognition of Jesus present with them, their hope was rekindled. They were able to acknowledge what they had been feeling as Jesus walked along with them. Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking with us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us? And Luke tells us that within the hour, they got up and headed back to Jerusalem to share with the other disciples what they had seen and what they had experienced. Revelation led to proclamation. What started on the road as the commiseration of dashed dreams and an uncertain future was transformed by Jesus through the interpretation of Scripture on the road and resulted in rekindled hope and an urgency to share that good news back on the road to Jerusalem. I would suggest that we would all do well to take time enough to ask ourselves, where am I on the road? Where am I on the road? Am I caught up in fear and disillusionment and hopelessness? Has Jesus come alongside me? Am I willing to engage and to listen? Or have I ignored him and sent him on along? Have I invited him to come into my home, my heart, my life? Does my heart burn within me to share the good news that he is with us? I said Easter Sunday that Easter isn't a day, it's a way of life. And last week, I encouraged all of us to practice resurrection. That is, to practice the life-giving reality that Jesus has defeated death, and that we can testify to that new birth through that truth. Today I want to remind us that this new life is not a sprint, but a marathon. We'll have moments of certainty and glimpses of doubt. We'll walk with confidence and then sometimes misstep into a pothole. We will go far, and sometimes we'll circle back to where we started. You see, we're on the road of faith. And no matter how easy or how difficult the going, Jesus is beside us every step of the way. Every step. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I would invite you, as you are able, to join me in our affirmation of faith. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen. And now, as a reconciled people, we are grateful to God for all of God's blessings as we sing our closing song.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting.
A lot of things that could confuse, disillusion, make us unhappy, angry, or sad, but there is one thing that is always true, and that is we can lean on the everlasting arms of Jesus. As we go forth into these 50 days of Easter, may we remember that he is with us every step of the way, and that he waits to hear what we have to say so that he can tell us what we need to hear. Go in peace. Amen.